You're listening to the audio production of The God Who Loves by John MacArthur, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Milton Bagby. To Patricia, whom I love more than life itself, and whose love for me is closer to heavenly perfection than anything I have known on earth. Introduction. A few years ago, I had the opportunity to spend several days traveling with Bill and Gloria Gaither, the well-known gospel musicians. At one point, I asked Bill what, in his estimation, were the greatest Christian lyrics ever written, aside from the inspired Psalms. Without hesitation, he began quoting the words from F.M. Lehman's The Love of God. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair, bowed down with care, God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned us from sin. When hoary time shall pass away and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who hear refuse to pray, on rocks and hills and mountains call, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong, redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints' and angels' song. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry. Nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong! It shall forevermore endure the saints' and angels' song. No lyrics in all hymnody surpass the third stanza of that song, he said. Indeed, few rivals come to mind. The poetry alone is beautiful, but the meaning is profound. As I pondered that song, my mind was flooded with echoes from Scripture. God is love, the Apostle John wrote, in 1 John chapter 4, verse 8 and verse 16. His loving kindness is everlasting, is the refrain for all 26 verses of Psalm 136. Those same words appear at least 41 times in the Old Testament. God's loving kindness is better than life itself, the psalmist reminds us. Psalm 63, verse 3. God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abundant in loving kindness and truth. Psalm 86, verse 15. He is good. His loving kindness is everlasting. Psalm 100, verse 5. Elsewhere, the psalmist writes, How precious is thy loving kindness, O God! And the children of men take refuge in the shadow of thy wings. Psalm 36, verse 7. And I will sing of the loving kindness of the Lord forever. Loving kindness will be built up forever. Psalm 89, verses 1 and 2. The New Testament unveils the ultimate proof of God's love. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. By this the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him, in the heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 6. And the most familiar verse of all says this: "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." John chapter 3, verse 16. No wonder the apostle exults: "See how great a love the Father has bestowed upon us." 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. Obviously, God's love and goodness are persistent themes in both the Old and New Testaments. If the amount of space the Bible gives the subject is any indication, hardly any truth about God is as important as his love. On almost every page of Scripture, we see divine goodness, tender mercies, loving kindness, patience, long-suffering, and grace. All those virtues are expressions of God's love. The doctrine of God's love is by no means simple. It raises a host of philosophical and theological difficulties. For example, some of the most obvious questions it brings up are these: if God is so loving, why does he send people to hell? Why does he allow sin and suffering and pain and sorrow? How can holocausts and natural disasters and other forms of mass destruction and human suffering exist in a universe designed by a God who is truly loving? Why did God allow the human race to be plunged into sin in the first place? In all honesty, we need to acknowledge the difficulty of questions like those. All of us have asked them. Many of us have been challenged with such questions from skeptics who ask us to provide satisfactory answers. If we're honest, we must admit that the answers are not easy. God himself has not seen fit to reveal full answers to some of those questions. Instead, he reveals himself as loving, all-wise, perfectly righteous, and supremely good, and he simply bids us trust him. That becomes easier the better we understand what Scripture teaches about the love of God. In this book, we will grapple with some of those difficult questions about God's love, but not until we've laid a good foundation for understanding what Scripture means when it says, "God is love." We must also note that several of the very worst corruptions of Christian truth are based on the notion that God can be understood solely in terms of his love. Those who hold such a perspective often refuse to acknowledge God's wrath against sin because they believe he cannot be both loving and angry with sinners. Others, perhaps intending to dissociate God from the tragedies and terrors of human experience, reason that if God is truly loving, he can't possibly be all-powerful. Otherwise, he would put a stop to all suffering. On the other hand, some well-meaning Christians concerned with doctrinal orthodoxy are so cautious about overemphasizing God's love that they fear to speak of it at all. Our culture, after all, is in love with sin and self-love, and utterly dull to the wrath of God against sin. Isn't it counterproductive to preach the love of God in the midst of such an ungodly society? Some who reason thus tend to see every bad thing that happens as if it were a direct judgment from the hand of a severe deity. Both extremes paint a distorted picture of God and further confuse the issue of understanding God's love. As long as we stay within the bounds of biblical truth about God's love, we can avoid both of these transgressions. As we examine what the Bible says about this subject, we will see how wonderfully God's love can be presented to sinners and how perfectly it fits with his hatred of sin. And the things hard to understand are made easier. In our pursuit of understanding on this matter, however, we must be willing to shed a lot of popular sentimental notions about divine love. Many of our favorite presuppositions about God need to be corrected. God's love and his holiness must be carefully understood in light of his wrath against sin. We must see love from the divine perspective before we can truly grasp the import of God's great love for us. The remedy, as always, is an open-hearted embracing of all the biblical data. And it is my design in this book to try to highlight a broad, balanced cross-section of that data. As the songwriter pointed out, to cover the subject as it deserves to be covered would drain the oceans of ink and fill a galaxy of skies. And even after many eons, the preface would barely be written. Eternity will be spent in just such a study, I am sure. That's why, for me, the opportunity to write this book has been like a little slice of heaven. As you read, I hope you will sense something of the heavenly glory as well, and learn that all the sadness, pain, and sorrow of human life do not negate the love of God to humanity. On the contrary, it is only the knowledge of His love in the midst of such trials that enables us to endure and be strengthened by them. We'll spend the first three chapters laying a foundation for understanding God's love. Beginning in chapter 4, we will return to deal with the hard questions we raised here, such as why God allows suffering. In the chapters that follow, we'll see how God's love defines who He is, how it applies to all humanity, and how it applies in a unique and special way to Christians. My prayer for all who read this book is an echo of Paul's prayer for the Ephesians, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 17 through 19. Chapter 1. God so loved the world. Love is the best known but least understood of all God's attributes. Almost everyone who believes in God these days believes that He is a God of love. I have even met agnostics who are quite certain that if God exists, He must be benevolent, compassionate, and loving. All those things are infinitely true about God, of course, but not the way most people think. Because of the influence of modern liberal theology, many suppose that God's love and goodness ultimately nullify His righteousness, justice, and holy wrath. They envision God as a benign heavenly grandfather, tolerant, affable, lenient, permissive, devoid of any real displeasure over sin, who, without consideration of His holiness, will benignly pass over sin and accept people as they are. God's love in recent church history. People in past generations often went to the opposite extreme. They tended to think of God as stern, demanding, cruel, even abusive. They so magnified God's wrath that they virtually ignored His love. Little more than 100 years ago, nearly all evangelistic preaching portrayed God only as a fierce judge whose fury burned against sinners. History reveals that some dramatic shifts in how we think of God have taken place over the past 3 centuries. Jonathan Edwards. Perhaps the most famous sermon ever preached in America was Jonathan Edwards's Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Edwards was a pastor in colonial Massachusetts and a brilliant theological mind. He preached his most famous sermon as a guest speaker in a church at Enfield, Connecticut, on July the 8th, 1741. This sermon sparked one of the most dramatic episodes of revival in the Great Awakening. Here is an excerpt that shows the preacher's graphic and frightening bluntness in portraying God's dreadful wrath against sinners. The God that holds you over the pit of hell, much as one holds a spider or some loathsome insect over the fire, abhors you and is dreadfully provoked. His wrath toward you burns like fire. He looks upon you as worthy of nothing else but to be cast into the fire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.